विश्वं दर्पण दृश्यमान नगरी तुल्यं निजान्तर्गतं पश्यन्नात्मनि मायया बहिरिवोद्भूतं यथा निद्रया यस्साक्षात् कुरुते प्रबोध समये स्वात्मानमेवाद्वयं तस्मै श्रीगुरुमूर्तये नमहिदं श्रीदक्षिणामूर्तये बीजस्यान्तरिवाङ्कुरो जगदिदं प्राङ्निर्विकल्पं पुनः मायाकल्पितदेशकालकलना वैचित्र्यचित्रीकृतं मायावीव विजृम्भयत्यपि महायोगी वयस्वेच्छया तस्मै श्रीगुरुमूर्तये नमहिदं श्रीदक्षिणामूर्तये तस्मै श्रीगुरुमूर्तये नमहिदं श्रीदक्षिणामूर्तये ॐ सहना भवतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम् ॐ साधनचतुष्टयं किम् नित्यानित्यवस्तु विवेकः इहामुत्रार्थफलभोगविरागः यु गॉट इट इहामुत्रार्थफलभोगविरागः शमादिषट्कसम्पत्तिः मुमुक्षुत्वं चेति So we started with this Nitya Nitya Vastu Vivekaha, and then it has been defined, and then afterwards each one has been elaborated. So that also we'll read now. Nitya Nitya Vastu Vivekaha Nitya Vastu Ekam Brahma Tadvyatiriktam सर्वं अनित्यं अयमेव नित्यानित्यवस्तु विवेकः नित्यानित्यवस्तु विवेक इस पुरुषार्थ विवेक डिसेंड आई मीन ह्यूमन लाइफ इट अपीयर्स फॉर एवरी ह्यूमन लाइफ देर आर फोर परस्यूट्स देर आर thousands and thousands of pursuits, even for a single person, single human being. But ultimately, Shastra has reduced all the purusharthas of all the human beings into four. That's all. And pursuits, as I told you, what is desired by a human being is called pursuit. Purushartha, as such. Purushaihi arthyate. And so it is purushartha. And here it is told that there are no four purusharthas. Better you discern. The person who is exposed to Vedanta has to discern, because Vedanta cannot fulfill the desire of dharma, artha and kama. Vedanta as such. Veda Purva can fulfill your desire, all other three. Other three purusharthas actually are fulfilled by Veda Purva, means karma kanda, dharma, artha, kama. But one who has crossed over the boundary of now karma kanda and has entered into Vedanta, for him there is only one purushartha. And therefore, to decide that there is only one purushartha and he is able to drop other three indicates a tremendous amount of emotional maturity. Therefore, first one has to go through the Veda Purva, that is the karma kanda portion. Kanda means a section. So the section of the Veda which talks about, which emphasizes karmas and upasanas, etc. And not for moksha purpose as such. not a direct means of moksha. They definitely fulfill your artha, kama, securities, pleasure, etc. And to an extent, you gain certain earnings, you earn something by which you can even secure for future also, securities and pleasures, hereafter. Yeah, you can. So for that you should, you cannot go bare hands. You should have some earning. If you want to stay in a five-star hotel, where better objects of, happiness are there, definitely you should need a lot of credit cards and everything. So ultimately all this is required. But one who has, got exposure to all these objects of, happiness and objects of security, he has, after analyzing all this, has come to the conclusion that basically he doesn't want anything actually. He doesn't want security, he doesn't want objects of happiness, or he doesn't want even a merits, etc., which can transform into future securities and happiness. He just wants a freedom. Such a person is called emotionally mature person. He enters into this Vedanta. For him, there is one purusharthā called freedom. He wants just freedom. And so we are analyzing how moksha is just one purusharthā and not other three. So that's called discrimination between the four purusharthas, in which dharma, artha, kama is on one side and moksha is on the other side. And here we started with the first thing is security. First, let us decide whether I really want objects of security or whether I want a freedom from insecurity. That's a question we have to answer to ourselves. Then one of them will be dropped. Whether I want objects of security called artha, or whether I want freedom from insecurity called moksha. And then if you get a weightage in the answering that yes, I want a freedom from insecurity, well, then you have discerned between the two. That artha, I really don't want artha, actually I want a freedom from insecurity, etc. So that's what we started with, so that you are really not seeking security, because since you cannot stand being insecure, that's how you are seeking all this. It means we are seeking actually the freedom from the sense of insecurity. I just want to get rid of that. And a sense of security seems to be persistent. That's a thing which we have to know. That sense of insecurity remains. Even after I fulfill the desire of getting an objects of security called artha, still this sense doesn't go. Well, then once you gain an object of security, you will remain secure forever in your life. It doesn't fulfill that wish. That's what. So even after I get objects of security called wealth, temporary it makes me free from the sense of insecurity. Definitely. It makes me feel. That's how I pursue. Why should I otherwise pursue? So when I get wealth, when I get name, fame, etc., everything, temporarily I become a free from the sense of insecurity. But then again it returns. And then again I strive for getting more securities so that I can become free from the sense of insecurity. So basically actually want a freedom from insecurity. That's what we want, because that's a persistent, that's a haunting thing to you, and that's how you want to become free from that. And since you feel insecure on your legs, so you definitely want crutches of security. That's what we are saying. And therefore, because they are just crutches, and the crutches will be there not forever. One day you will have to drop. In fact, you want to drop. And if you don't want to drop, doctor will tell you to drop it. They say you remove. You can walk independently. Remove the stick. Remove the stick. No, no, no. I may fall down. I may fall down. I may fall down. So that shows that he holds on to security, so-called crutches, because that sense of insecurity doesn't go. So basically, I want a freedom from insecurity. That's what we have to discern. So If I just keep pursuing the objects of security called artha pursuit, then definitely I remain eternal seeker of security. And I don't want to be eternal seeker of security. I want to put an end to the sense of security centered on the self. So I want freedom. Freedom from insecurity. Please understand this. This is a very, 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 very essential for you to commit to this knowledge. I mean to the means of moksha, basically. To understand this, people sometimes, because of Purusharth Viveka is not there, even by God's grace, they have exposure to Vedanta and everything. Since the Purusharth Viveka is not there, their commitment to the means of knowledge called Vedanta is not full. It's not full-hearted. Because they feel that the security for security purpose, he has to have a pursuit of artha in the world, called name, fame, etc., house and other everything. Even children also is a means of security, by the way. I didn't say yesterday, but then everything. I want a child because I want to survive through the child. To survive, to live is all security. Yeah. Insecurity means what? Threat to the survival. Threat to the living is insecurity. So I want to survive. I want to put my name somewhere so that I can survive. Because I know the form will not remain. That much philosophy I have. The form will not remain. But then the name which is given to the form can continue after the form goes. And therefore, people definitely, if they want to survive through the name, because of the love for security, love for getting freedom from being insecure, they have a children. So with the children, their name will be there. Here also it may be there, but in India definitely name of a father, mother, etc. would be, especially father's name would be there. I mean, that is how it is. Or else you do some benevolent actions, charity, etc., so that your name will be put somewhere and that will be there forever. So at least I will survive through the name. Really? It's very genuine desire. Of course, we feel it's very, you know, funny. But actually, it's a desire for a very, very desire. And it's a natural desire. You cannot erase it. No way you can erase it. Whatever surgery a doctor does to your mind, to your brain, this will not go. A love for survival. A love for survival will just not go. And we are analyzing today that love for survival, there is further we will have to go into that. But right now this much. So a sense of insecurity is all the time persistent between the life and death. And we have seen yesterday this conclusion is born. This judgment about the self is born, not it's a real judgment, it's born of ignorance of the self. Rather, and born of the ignorance of the self or self-confusion, and that's how discrimination is required. Since there is a confusion regarding the self, something non-self is considered as a self, and therefore the non-self or the body, etc., well, it's going to die, it is subject to aging, it is subject to death. And so I also consider I am subject to death. And therefore I feel all the time a sense of insecurity within. And I want to get rid of it. So anyway, because the two things are mixed up, I am called the body and this Atma. And therefore, it's a very crude way I'm telling it is not, there are two things, you know, like wheat and something else. They are mixed up. And therefore we will have to separate here also. Two things are there, and therefore we have to separate physically. Nothing. If physical separation is required, Vedanta is not required. Because you have to do something. By knowing, you cannot. If I mix up two things, suppose, then knowing that there are two things will not help. You have to really separate. But here they say just by knowing, you become free. I mean free from the self-judgment that you are insecure. Means actually two things are not mixed up. There is a delusion that two things are mixed up. That's the thing. There is a delusion. Whole phenomena is as though mixed up. as though everything is though, as though. This self, which the confused self is as though really not confused. That's a big, big grace. Really, it's a big grace. That's how Swamiji used to tell that, you know, you sit on a lazy boy chair and take a cup of coffee and just do something separation here and that's all. You need not get up forever, you know. But I mean, need not get up forever means you can enjoy throughout the life without doing anything. I'm of such kind of a person who doesn't like to do anything. And so what you are trying to know and what you want to achieve has no distance. That's a big thing. Knowing this thing, I have to do something for moksha, etc. Well, it's not going to work. So far as this thing, this notion is there, Vedanta is not going to work. It's definitely not going to work. Vedanta works for the person who knows clearly that the knowledge only is moksha. Just knowing is moksha. Dropping the conclusion that I am insecure is the security, is the self. Dropping the conclusion that I am insecure is gaining security in life. That's all. Anyway. So we have to discover this, sorry, it's a long way. But, so there is a confusion, and so all the time there is a question we have to ask, is there any confusion regarding the self, centered on the self? Well, if there is a confusion, then definitely you have to get rid of it. And I'm insecure is definitely a, such a kind of a conclusion, which is nothing but a confusion. This conclusion is nothing but a confusion, and therefore I just want to have a freedom from insecurity. I need not acquire security, because any amount of insecurity I acquire is going to be time bound. That's what it is going to be told. Tad vyatiriktam sarvam anityam. Sarvam means it includes everything. Tad vyatiriktam means before that something is told, brahma nityam, etc. But tad vyatiriktam sarvam, sarvam means this world in which you are seeking some objects for security, some objects for happiness, well, it is anityam. It is not going to give you. It, they promise you that, yeah, you acquire us, we will give you security. Once they come, they create a sense also that, yeah, I am secure now. But the, again, that sense of insecurity appears. That perhaps I may not be interested in artha, I may not be interested in objects of security. Perhaps I want to get freedom from the sense of insecurity. I want freedom from insecurity rather than acquiring objects of insecurity. Objects of security. Correct? So between artha and moksha, you have discerned the problem. That's what it means. Same way, now we'll go to another purushartha, kama, seeking pleasures. Pleasures means, you know, all conducive situation wherein you can, you know, tap some happiness. Yeah. By acquiring something, you have a better sense of well-being. By acquiring something, you have better sense of, you know, let's say happiness. Better sense of happiness, I should not say, but better sense of well-being, better sense of a comfort you have. And so that is, then you pursue those kind of objects which can create such a kind of a sense in you. And those pursuit is called kama. I mean, objects of happiness. What does it mean? Oh, it means I am unhappy. That means I am unhappy. That's how I pursue what? Objects of happiness. So I am unhappy means that's how I am naturally seeking happiness. Like I am seeking some particular kind of a grocery. Then same way I am seeking now happiness somewhere in the objects. But unfortunately, there is no object called happiness. We will have to discover first what this pursuit is. So actually, there is no object called happiness. In fact, I am not really seeking. It's not the happiness that I want. I want to be a happy person. I will have to explain this. I will repeat this. It's not that happiness I want. Actually, I want a happy self. That's what we have to see. Because if I'm seeking happiness, I mean, I'm branding a particular object lying in a Stroudsburg, and it's a happiness, and then it is there in some grocery store, and then I and other people all will make a beeline towards that, and because everyone will have 1 unit, 2 units of happiness, as per your buying power, you can buy, definitely. Because we buy objects of happiness, we definitely say that way only. Yeah? Objects of happiness. I mean, the happiness is there in the object. So I am saying it is just a happiness. Yeah, so we definitely will buy it. But we come to know that for buying such an, or let us for getting this object called happiness, people go in opposite directions, right? Actually, they should go to a particular direction where it is available. Like, before I enter into that, I will tell you one example of here only. I just imagine that way. That there is some particular kind of a grain available in Stroudsburg. Then the person from Bethlehem also has to go there. I remember the 2-3 city names of place, because it will be difficult otherwise. So from Bethlehem also he has to go there, or from Silosburg also he has to go there. No, Swamiji, such a kind of grain is not only available in Stroudsburg, it's available in New Jersey. Okay, that's fine, I understand that. But person, suppose, to buy a particular that grain, person from Stroudsburg comes to Silosburg, and the person from Silosburg goes to Stroudsburg, well, there is a confusion, right? Because person is coming here to buy that particular grain, but person from here goes to Stroudsburg. How it is possible? If it is available here, he need not go there. No, but Swamiji, it is available there. Then why the person from Stroudsburg comes here? Could you follow what I am saying? Why people go in opposite direction for buying an object called happiness? No, Swamiji, people don't go to in opposite direction. People go in opposite direction. For what? For buying happiness, for getting happiness, for getting an object called happiness. One person goes to beach for happiness. Other person leaves the beach for happiness. One person goes up to the mountain hurriedly. In hurry he is going. And other person is just coming down hurriedly also. If you ask both, they say, yeah, in search of happiness, we are running around. Opposite direction. That shows it's a confusion. Definitely confusion. One person goes from east to the west, and in the morning, 7 o'clock, he sits in a car. For what? Gaining happiness. Goes to the west. This other person from the west, in the morning, 7 o'clock, sits in the car. Goes to the east. Aray, don't go to east. The person is coming from that side only to gain happiness in this direction. So it is here for, in your direction. No, 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 no. If you go to the, any street, you will find the traffic is on all the directions. And everyone has a single motto, want to gain object called happiness. Oh, Swamiji, that is not correct. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So, in fact, if it is not a happiness if person is interested or he wants, person wants to have a happy self, to be a happy person. Anyway, so nobody seeks happiness because it is neither in the east, nor in the south, nor in the north, nor it is neither up nor down. All that one wants to be the happy self. And where is the happy self? Everyone is searching right now. Everyone is searching. Happy self. Self will be never away. But anyway, he is searching. Self is here. Non-self is outside, right? But he is searching happy self in the beach. He is searching happy self on the top of the mountain. He is searching happy self in caves. Anywhere. One is searching happy self in the space. Other is searching happy self in the bottom of the sea. Sir, happy self. You are saying you are in search of happy self. Then self cannot be away from you. What is away from you is what? Non-self. No, but something is there. I think that the happy self is away from me, and it may be in the places. It may be away from me. Well, anyway, so all the time one is seeking. See how, what a, the whole pursuits are so, so, no, we should not say foolish, but they are. If you analyze in light of Vedanta through the teachers, you find it is all, it falls apart, really speaking, falls apart. So all the time one is seeking a happy self. Now, when you are seeking happy self, what kind of a self you have right now? Oh, simple, Swamiji, unhappy self. I would not say that. I would not say. Because that is not the experience of a person. It's not that you are all the time unhappy. It's not so. Right now, let's say, right now. You say, you can't say that I am unhappy right now. If person 24 by 7, multiply 365 and multiply 60 years, unhappy self, one would commit suicide. But we would like to put it a little differently. Not that one experiences oneself unhappy self as unhappy self all the time, but I am not happy self. That kind of a thing persist. All is not well with me persist. Positively, unhappiness is not experienced all the time. Please understand this. But I am not happy totally. All is not well with me. I'm not totally comfortable. That sense continues, in which sometime positively you become unhappy also. That's what I want to convey. So all the time you are not unhappy as such, but all is not well with me. I'm not totally comfortable, except those moments of experience, on the moments of experience in which in the waking state you have got a certain moments of joy, or in the deep sleep state you are totally comfortable. Except then that, except those moments, certain moments of waking state and the experience of a deep sleep state, all the time that sense continues, that all is not well with me. That is, I'm not happy self, that notion continues. And that is how, in search of happy self, definitely I move around. Since I'm uncomfortable with myself, since I'm not. All is not well with me, that kind of a sense I have centered on the self, I continue in search of a comfortable self or happy self. And what happens? Yeah, then you desire certain objects which can make you happy. A happy self arises in you. So you get a desired object and you become happy self also. That's experience. That's how a pursuit of kama is there. Pursuit of happiness, objects of happiness are there, and they create in you a sense of happy self momentarily. Momentarily, it definitely creates. And again, that I am unhappy, I am not happy self continues, right? It's happening. This is how it continues. And then again, you seek some other objects which can create a sense in you that I am happy self. Then again, this sense appears again. What? I am not happy self. Again it continues. Therefore, you are seeking the objects of happiness, really not seeking for the sake of objects. You want to have a freedom from not happy self. You want to have a freedom from not happy self, in which unhappy self also you should add. You want to have a freedom from unhappy self. So here also, between kama and moksha, definitely you are interested in moksha, freedom from a sense. I am saying a sense, but let us drop even that. Freedom from unhappy self plus freedom from not happy self. Let's say that way. So you will be accounted for. Because not happy self, not a piece, but it is there all the time. One is not comfortable. Then you, no, Swamiji, but I don't feel so. Just compare a moment of joy and a right now, then you will find immediately. Not that I am positively unhappy, but there is some sense that I'm not so comfortable as I was comfortable in the moment of joy. That's how it has become a norm. Please remember this, what I told in the first class. It has become a norm or a standard for you. With respect to that, right now, if you compare yourself, you definitely find, yeah, such a moment of joy or a comfort level is not there with me right now. When I get some object, again that comfort level arises to that standard, and then it goes off, and then again you become like that, and then again you seek some object, that's called kama pursuit. You seek some object of happiness, again you find happy self, again you come down to the sense of not happy self, and then again you seek. Oh, means I want basically freedom from not happy self plus unhappy self, including all. Okay? So this is how I want. And that's how between kama and moksha also, really speaking, I want moksha, freedom from not happy self. And that's a self-judgment. I am not happy with myself. I am uncomfortable with myself. I am dissatisfied with myself. That sense which is persistently there throughout the life, I want to get rid of. I want freedom from that. Well, then moksha is a pursuit. So between artha and kama also, moksha is a pursuit. Between kama and moksha also, moksha is a pursuit. Could you follow? Now this is how basically we are saying this is, so there is not artha that you are seeking, not kama that you are seeking. What you think, you start with artha, kama and everything, and when you do this discriminative inquiry, you end up in one purushartha called moksha. You have decided that yes, I don't want actually artha and kama, I want to get rid of this particular judgment about myself. For that purpose, I take it as a crutches for security. Certain other objects, take them as a crutches for happiness, right? For security and happiness. But basically, the centered on the self, I have a judgment about insecurity and not happy self, I want to get rid of, actually. That's how between the two, between artha and this moksha, kama and moksha, actually I want moksha. So could you follow? You want moksha. You want freedom. Freedom from insecurity, freedom from not happy self. That's a thing which persists. You want to have it. Now third purusharatha is still there. And we have talked very big, big things about it. Now that also has to be put into the basket of artha and kama. We have to do that. We'll have to do. Third is a dharma. And I gave you meaning of dharma as say, dharma means a merits, punyam. And dharma means a purushartha. I told you it's a big, very, very, very big purushartha in which you really become mature, you become adult and all that, you know, self-growth and, you know, like physical growth, I told you that yesterday, weightlifting. Same way, if dharma makes you really grow, this is mental growth. In weightlifting, physical growth, but then ultimately it's growth, and I'm interested in growth. Then you are going to drop it in a drop box? Yeah, we are going to put in a drop box of artha and kama. Yeah. First, dharma means, let us say, punyam. Why do you want punyam? Oh, but it's a currency I want for better artha and kama. How do you say? But heaven is like here, like this world. No, it is better world. Okay, let's go there. No. Let me wait and see. Because I don't know whether heaven is there or not. First thing. And even if it is there, what kind of heaven, I don't know. People sometimes narrate very beautiful things. And when you go there, there is nothing. Then I will lose this place also. And then I won't get there also. So I want to wait. But let's say now you are a Vaidika. You are committed to the Vedas, and what Veda says, you have a tremendous Shraddha, and so you believe. And Veda says Swarga is something where, like you are here in this loka, there, you know, the other yonis are there, called Deva yonis. Devatas stay there. Okay, what kind of devatas? Oh, you live here 100 years. they live 10,000 years, 20,000 years, 40,000 years. Oh, yeah. Then I want this 100 years create insecurity, right? Small life. Then that one all, that is better. But that's also a limited, we should know. Because after you leave there, because of your currency, you are put in a 5-star hotel, but you will have to come out. Once your credit cards are exhausted, you will have to come out. Then what? No, then I don't want. I want to live. I want to be secure. I want to survive. Survive, 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 survive. All the time. I want to live. Tomorrow you want to live? Yeah, tomorrow. Then day after tomorrow? Yeah, day after tomorrow. After 10 years? Yeah, I want to live. Swamiji, that's not correct. It's not correct. Shall I tell you one thing? Why people commit suicide? That shows there is no love for living. Yeah, but then we are saying you want to live and live happily. Suppose I give you a place. Then are there enjoyments? Yeah, enjoyments. Devatas have very beautiful enjoyments. So you can live long. And you can live long with happiness. You want? Yeah, I want. For that, what should I do? Unmarriage? On some punyam? Oh, so dharma is a pursuit? Yeah, dharma is a pursuit. But then those enjoyments will remain forever for me? No. So long as your currency, what you are earning is there, they will keep you. Once your cards are exhausted, you will be dropped here in that too in a gulf where the temperature is 50 degrees centigrade. You will be dropped there. So you want basically earth and kama there. And why do you want? Because I have a sense of insecurity. I have a sense of not being happy self. That's how I want there also, the same thing. So better it's that you want to have a freedom from the sense of insecurity. You want to have a freedom from not happy self. Ultimately, not happy self is your judgment. Unhappy self is your judgment. You want to get rid of it. That's how, if it cannot, these objects cannot fulfill here. The artha and kamas are not fulfilled here. I want to go there because they give a happiness for a long time. I can live long. A sense of security is much better than sense of security which is here. Therefore, I want to go there. But that is also going to end. No, then it's not a purusharta. Could you follow? It, because after once you return, you will have the same sense of insecurity and not happy self. And therefore, see what a human mind wants. It wants forever. That sense of insecurity should go forever. Sense of not happy self should go forever. Not from any other thing. Please understand this. Centered on the self. That's a very big thing. Centered on the self you don't want. This is insecure. This is time bound. No problem. This will survive for 5 years, no problem. You are comfortable. You will utilize it in 5 years so much that it will, you know, its life will end in 2.5 years. You will utilize it that way. Yeah, you are very comfortable. When everything else is dying, you don't have any problem. But you are dying. No. Centered on the self, please understand this. It is going to convey a very big thing. On non-self, there is insecurity, they are time-bound, I don't mind. They could not give happiness, they are inert and this thing, I don't mind. But I am insecure, no way. Means you want freedom from this very idea, from the judgment that I am insecure. For that, you are moving here and there. Somebody is promising a longer security, well, I am interested in. Some objects are in some places, offer that you can have objects of happiness for a long time, good varieties, aesthetic. Well, I'm interested. Aesthetic. Yeah, you are interested. But ultimately, that is also going to end. Is it acceptable? No. well, then you want a freedom from basically unhappy self or not happy self. Basically, you want that only. And therefore, you are in dharma purushartha also is not going to work. Between dharma and moksha also, you are basically interested in moksha only. You are not interested in any objects, objects of this or objects of that. That's going to come. Iha amutra phalabhoga viraga. It's going to come. From the viveka, if you do, immediately which is born in your mind is dispassion. It's going to have a dispassion towards objects of this world or objects of that world. Because ultimately they are not going to erase a self-judgment that I am insecure. No one has the capacity in this entire universe which can erase this self-judgment. I am insecure or I am not happy self. Well, then I am no more interested in that. That's a dispassion will come later. So this is how it goes. So we are doing just a purushartha viveka. Artha and moksha, I am really interested in moksha. Kama and moksha, I am interested in moksha. Dharma and moksha, I am interested in moksha. But Swamiji, you said the other meaning of dharma. Conforming to value structure and self-growth and, you know, you talk everything in flowery language yesterday. So what about that? I did not, but anyway, people may feel that conforming to universal value structure and creates a harmony within and self-acceptance and all that. And that's adulthood of the mind and beautiful, beautiful, all these things. Even after self-growth, you will not be free from the self-judgment that I am a limited being, I am a mortal being. Even after, you know, creating a harmony in your life, following a dharma, following to the universal value structure, that which makes your mind, which makes your mind adult, which makes your mind adult, mature, in which there is no conflict. This person is spontaneously doing what is supposed to be done and not doing what is not to be done. So generally, as I told you, this adult mind is, the characteristic of the adult mind is this. Whether I like it or not, what I am supposed to do, I will do. That's adulthood. And I like what I do what I like. Whether I am not supposed to do, I don't care. That's a child. What I'm not supposed to do, I don't care. But if I like, I will do it. But you should not do. No, I will do. Well, then this is a childish mind. Yeah. But whether I like it or not, what I'm supposed to do, I will do. What I'm not supposed to do, I will not do. And that is called conformation to the structure, universal structure of right and wrong. What I'm supposed to do is right thing. What I'm not supposed to do means it is a wrong thing. Well, I conform myself to that, not conform to my likes and dislikes, and conform to right and wrong, which is universally there. Well, it's an adulthood of the mind. It makes you grow. How can, but where is the growth? Growth is something which is really painful, you know. Growth is a painful thing, little. And when you start doing that way from today, suppose you have a resolve. What I am supposed to do from today, I will do. Getting up in the morning at 4 o'clock and see what happens tomorrow at 4 o'clock. Is there happiness? No. It's painful. Initially painful because conflicts between personal value structure of likes and dislikes and universal structure. There is a conflict. Kaurava and Pandava. That's how it is. Kaurava and Pandava, these are the Shatrus. Likes and dislikes are Shatrus, enemies. Dharma means Pandava. That is Mahabharata. Mahabharata starts at 4 o'clock in the morning. Kurukshetra is here. Dharma Kshetre, Kuru Kshetre. Kuru, Kuru, Kuru. That's how it has been explained. In really speaking, it has been explained that way. Kuru, Kuru. Kuru means, you know, in it's a Sanskrit word. It's a verb basically. Kuru means you do. Yeah. So Kurukshetra means Karmakshetra. Yeah, and this is Karmakshetra. Yeah, this is Karmakshetra. ह्यूमन लाइफ इज ओनली वन वेयर वन कैन डू कर्म, अदर लिविंग बींग्स आर नॉट डूइंग एनी एक्शन एक्चुअली, दे आर जस्ट चेष्टास बिकॉज दे आर जस्ट दे डोंट हैव अ चॉइस. वेयर देर इज अ चॉइस देर इज अ कर्म, वेयर देर इज अ फ्रीडम टू डू नॉट टू डू टू डू अदरवाइज एक्सेट्रा, वेल दैट्स अ फ्रीडम. And therefore, that's available, that facility is in only in human life. And therefore, this is Kurukshetra, and well, it can become Dharmakshetra also. Yeah, right? You can conform to the universal value structure, and thereby you can grow, and ultimately you can gain even moksha also. It's just a penultimate step, very near, honestly. Dharma and moksha are very, very close, very close. In dharma also, the result would be a self-acceptance. Really, you accept your... See, because what happens is when you conform to what is right and wrong, and since it is universally present, it is present here. You need not have to refer the books. What is to be done, what is not to be done, really you need not. You know very well all these things. And therefore, basically, when you conform to, you will have a better sense of yourself. Otherwise, in your own eyes, you fall down. And that's how I gave an example. If what you are do, you do. You are supposed to do, you do. You will have a better sense of yourself. You accept, your acceptance of yourself is better. Like I gave you example of a laundry. Even after doing everything, you feel that everything is okay with me. Because what you are supposed to do, you have done. You want to get up in the morning and you got up. You will have a better sense of yourself. Yeah, what I'm supposed to do, and I did it. But what you are supposed to do and you don't do, then in your own eyes, you will fall down. After a while, you will have another self-judgment that in my life, what I want to achieve, I am not able to achieve. That's it. So you fall down in your own eyes. So dharma actually creates a self-acceptance. Self-respect, everything it creates. You start loving yourself, really speaking. Because you don't want yourself to be the person who has a value of something and could not achieve the value. And therefore, this gives a better sense of an acceptance. And when self-acceptance relatively arises, well, moksha is very near, in which there is total self-acceptance, because you know yourself as a limitless. That's what you want. When you know yourself as a limitless, you accept yourself totally. When you know that you are a very limited being, and that's how you want to come out of that limitations, you are not able to accept yourself. When you know yourself limitless, you definitely accept yourself also totally. So dharma is a very near purushartha to the moksha, very near. That's how the people having arthakama pursuits will not gain moksha. But if they follow dharma and gain arthakama, well, one or other day they will grow and they will definitely gain moksha. So even if you grow to a great extent mentally, I mean you become emotionally mature, that particular sense of the judgment about yourself will be always there. I am immortal, I am imperfect, etc. Or I am a limited being. That will not go. And you want to have a freedom from that thing. Therefore, dharma also is not a ultimate purushartha. Basically, you want a freedom. Freedom from the sense of immortality. Freedom from the sense of imperfection. Freedom from the sense of limitation, you want to come out of it. So between dharma and moksha also, ultimately is moksha is the purushartha. Could you follow what I am saying? So if I am imperfect, how can I become imperfect? Suppose, how can I become perfect? No way. If your nose is imperfect, how will you make it perfect? No way. If my eyes are imperfect, limited, how can I make it without or free from all the limitations? It's impossible. It's not. If an imperfect goes to any place, he will see imperfection is everywhere. That's how it is. So imperfect being can never become perfect. Whatever you do artha, you do kama, if you are imperfect, after pursuing artha, getting objects of insecurity, you still remain a limited being in terms of security. Even in terms of happiness also, you acquire any number of objects and you see yourself as limited in terms of happiness, and you acquire thousands of objects, still you are limited in happiness. So, and even in terms of dharma also, it is the same thing. Even if you go to heaven, you as an imperfect being, you go there, you remain imperfect even throughout the time or period you live in heaven. An imperfect being sees imperfection everywhere. And therefore, I am not seeking actually perfection. What I am seeking is a freedom from the sense of imperfection. And therefore, dharma, artha and kama are not purushartha. Because the sense of imperfection, limitation, sense of mortality, sense of insecurity, sense of the sorrow, etc., sense of not happy with myself, sense of unhappiness, all these things remain as it is. Temporarily when you acquire or you get rid of something, temporarily you feel, like you, maybe certain objects I have not talked about, but certain objects are such you feel that if you give it up, you will have a better sense of security. And it definitely creates. Like you get rid of certain people, you feel that you let me leave away from this person, then I will have a better sense of security. And it creates. But then again, the sense of insecurity comes back. So then you want a freedom. You want a freedom. All this is you are doing here and there is because that is haunting you inside. So you want basically freedom. Freedom from insecurity, not anywhere else. Let it be anything, be insecure. I don't mind. But this, I want that this coronavirus should be insecure. Yeah, it should die. Immediately it should die. They die or not, that's a different thing. But we want other things to be time bound sometimes. Yes. We want them to be time bound. And certain things, if you don't want time bound, but you accept, yeah, that this thing is like that. Everyone has a shelf life, they call. Everyone has a shelf life. And therefore, according to the shelf life, you consume. Like medicines. You know, certain medicine, B12s, etc., there is a sublingual drops, shelf life. So Swami used to always see, what is the expiry date? Before that, I will want to consume. I mean, you have accepted they are time bound. Yeah, I have accepted. Okay, you are also time bound. No. No. Never. I will see that I will not be time bound. Could you follow? A natural love for survival, security, natural love to be timeless. It's there. Natural love, please understand this. You cannot get rid of. Cannot. Life after life, Bhagavan gives you in order to really get the freedom from the sense of insecurity. But we feel some objects make me timeless, secure. Some objects make me happy, comfortable, satisfaction, fullness. You feel so. They know. They don't. So anitya. Those objects are anitya. They are time bound. Time bound not in terms of time only. Anitya indicates quality also. Other things also are included in that. Anyway, so how many purusharthas do we have now? Only one. Hush. After 1 hour we have achieved that. So except for dharma initially as a growth, which can be called as a purushartha, everything else is not a purushartha. That means artha kama is not a purushartha. And in the pursuit of artha and kama, you discover growth, the self-growth, means following the dharma, following an inaction, you definitely then you grow also. You are pursuing artha kama, at the same time growing also, but ultimately that purushartha is limited also, because that will not make you free, make you free from the judgment about yourself, the conclusion about yourself that you are a limited being. Dharma also cannot fulfill this promise, cannot. Because when you pursue the, just let me, because yesterday I talked, I want to tell this thing, even you do follow dharma, etc. But you are this body, that sense is going to be there, right? That sense is going to be there. And when you say you are a body, well, the sense of mortality will not go, center of the self. Sense of limitation will not go, because the body is limited in time. Therefore, body is subject to death, body is subject to all kinds of viruses and everything. And therefore, you are subject to all this, and so insecurity will not go. Sense of mortality will not go, it will be there. And therefore, dharma also, to an extent, it can make you qualify, let us say. It can make you grow from the hold of artha and kama to an extent. Following a dharma, you pursue all these things, definitely it make you mature also, correct? It can make you free from the hold of likes and dislikes, personal value structure also. But it can never make you a perfect being, a limitless being. You want a limitlessness or a timelessness, let us say everything, but it cannot. And therefore, when we have to choose between dharma and moksha, we definitely have to choose moksha. So ultimately, moksha is the only purushartha in my life. And so that since I don't know, let everybody is seeking, somebody asked, everyone is seeking moksha, then why people go towards other pursuits? Because there is a confusion. What is the confusion? The fallacy of the conclusion that I am insecure is not discerned. It's not discriminated or is not discerned. So I am seeking freedom actually from insecurity is not discerned, and that's how, because of that, I seek security, etc. I am seeking freedom from being unhappy is not discerned properly, and so I seek happiness or happy self. I seek happiness, happy self, manipulating the world, manipulating the mind. I do that. Because if I want to be happy self, I have to manipulate the world. Some people manipulate the world, some people manipulate their own mind. But everyone wants to confront with a happy self. And so this is how the thing is going on. This is called samsara. When you manipulate the world or manipulate the mind in order to confront the happy self or in order to confront a secure self, well, you are in a process of samsara. Because right now you have a notion about yourself, a judgment about yourself. I am insecure, I will become secure. I am unhappy self or I am not happy self, I will become happy self. Well, you are in a process of becoming. Yeah, I'm in the process of becoming. Well, it's a samsara. It's a samsara. Samsara, we have already told, samyak sarati. The sarat means a very well, nicely, you know, he's like a you know, what is it? The children play and, you know? Slide, yeah. It's like, it's just a sliding. It's a process of sliding, beautifully. Becoming after becoming after becoming after becoming. I become secure, again get the sense that I'm insecure. Then again get some object. I become secure, again drop down. That sense again appears. Then I become happy self. Then again I become self which is not happy. This is process, goes on and on. That's how samsara is a person who is having the pursuit of artha, kama and dharma. And the person who has discerned this and has chosen now moksha as a purusartha, discerning that really through artha, kama and dharma he was really seeking the freedom, is a mumuksha. He wants how to have moksha. For him there is only one goal, not four, only one. So he has done? Discrimination. Viveka. What is a viveka? Nitya nitya vastu viveka. He has done. And of course, now here we'll have to add few things. Now a morning, little, the person, this person who discerned this way definitely has come in contact with the scriptures. Otherwise, in a world, if you say you are really, you know, basically you are seeking moksha. What is that moksha? He says that way. So the person who comes discerned this way between the purusharatha definitely is connected to the Veda. He has exposure of Veda. It is called apata jnanam. Apata jnanam means you come across. You come across a book. You come across a swami. You come across some listening in which they talk about this purusharatha. And also they say nityam vastu ekam brahma. This is the advantage of the Vedic, you know, background. Veda tells there is one vastu, one reality, which is called a non-dual, which is Brahman. And Brahman means which is nityam, and that alone you want in your life. When you come across Brahman, then that's freedom. You will get that freedom. Freedom from what? Freedom from insecurity, freedom from not being happy self, freedom from this mortality, everything. That, you know, that such a thing called Brahman is there. Better you seek Brahman now. That's what Veda says. Yeah. We are going one step ahead also in this tomorrow, of course. And therefore, basically, Brahman is something which is timeless. Brahman is something which is purnam, fullness. And that will give you a freedom from the sense of freedom. Because since it is timeless, once you gain it, and then you will never have a sense of insecurity. Because it will be always with you. It will be always with you. Since it is always with you, you will remain secure. But how can it make me secure? Because it is timeless. Once it comes, it will not go. Once it comes, it will not go. And being timeless, it will be always there. What is timeless? What is timeless? Which is always there. That's called timeless. Right? Am I making a sense? So what is timeless will never go. Never go. What is in time, which is time bound, comes and goes. What comes and goes is time bound. Something timeless means which will never go. And then what comes and goes, you know, will, when it comes, you will have a sense of security. When it goes, you will have a sense of again insecurity. That's how happening. That's how happening. That's how some people are objects of security for us. Yeah. We feel they are there, I'll be secure. And some, it happens all the time. Whether you, sometimes you may not, you will not remain. Sometimes the person will not remain. Either you go, or either he or she goes. One of them has to go. That's how in India they always discuss, married people. Who will go first? Who will go first? In India they discuss. Especially the retired people discuss this. We have lived a long life and so happy life we have. You know, we are celebrating now 50 years of our marriage anniversary, but now one of them has to go. Who will go first? They say, sense of insecurity. Something comes, yeah, I have a sense of security. Something goes, well, then it is time bound. What comes and goes is a time bound. But if I am giving you something which is timeless, just this is, doesn't make sense, don't worry, tomorrow it will make sense. So something timeless, itself timeless comes, it doesn't fit, but you make it fit somehow. Well, you know, something timeless which I give you, well, and it will always be with you. Yeah, that will give me a sense of security. I become get a freedom from the sense of insecurity forever. I'm in search of such object which will make me secure forever, or which will make me free from the sense of insecurity forever. I'm in search of that. Veda tells, proclaims rather, nityam vastu ekam brahma. Such a Brahman is there, which you should find out. Where it is, we don't know, but you find out. Better you find out. Then you acquire it. And and then you, it will be always with you. You need not have to worry that it will go away somewhere, someday, nothing to worry. Tad vyatiriktam sarvam anityam. Other than that, what you have acquired in past, you know better than me. Veda says, you know better than me. They are all anityam. They have come and gone. Ayaram, gayaram. We call like that. Ayaram, gayaram. Abhi abhi aya, abhi abhi gaya. Hindi. Oram aya or gaya. Aya, gaya. Had come, gone. Had come, gone. This is how samsari is life. Something came, gone, gone, gone. And one day, I am gone. Oh, that's how. This is how it is. All samsara. A life of becoming and life of this, you know. A life of time-bound pursuits is a life of samsara. You want something timeless. You want something, one more thing. You want something which won't change. He promises that I am timeless. Better you acquire me, and once it comes, and then say sorry. I have to go. We promise to each other that we will be there forever, but then I'm sorry. Tad vyatiriktam sarvam anityam. We'll have to see where is it, where is this Brahman. Once, and its nature is like this. Its nature of timelessness will not change. Well, then I'm interested. Definitely, I'm interested. Okay, we'll see that. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om.